We start with New Mexico In Focus correspondent Antoni Gonzalez and her conversation with 2022's Miss Indian New Mexico, Alicia Cariz.
Miss Indian New Mexico, welcome to New Mexico In Focus.
Oh, thank you so much for the invitation, Antonia. It means a lot. It's, you know, nice to see you in community. We've had a lot of different encounters in all of my different hats that I wear, so I'm glad to see you in a new hat.
Well, please introduce yourself.
Hello, let's go traditional. Go etsi, emera hopa, Alicia Christmas, Giva Mesota, Schultzen Hana Bokowitz, Hin L, Miss Indian New Mexico 54 for 2022 to 2023. Hello, my name is Alicia Cariz. I am from the Pueblo of Santo Domingo, and I am your Miss Indian New Mexico 54 for the 2022 to 2023 year.
And you just recently were crowned with this title. You're an ambassador for Native women, a role model for Native youth. Tell me a little bit about your role.
Yes, it is such an amazing experience so far. We've been a little bit over a month, and you know, just really understanding that I am a public servant to not only our 23 tribal nations in the state of New Mexico, but for the state as a whole, as well as understanding that this title is a pillar of hope for all of our communities. And it's also another space for me to, you know, utilize this platform to call forth and inspire others to, you know, continue to be the solutions to their community's needs.
And what was your platform when you were running?
My platform has always and will be empowerment through community building. And what I mean by that is, you know, when we get our community people together to, you know, have conversations and connect with one another and continue to build a deeper understanding of the issues and the impacts that, you know, the challenges that we face. This is a time where we're able to meet and continue to build community together. And that's all part of how we honor ourselves through kinship, through community. And as well as when we find that connection, we feel that we have the support system. We are building that system in order for us to feel empowered to have a voice and continue to regroup as a community and find the solutions and be the solutions.
And your role is not only just visiting tribal communities and going to tribal events, that's definitely a big part of sharing Native culture, but also just to the general public. So why is that important to share Native culture with the general public and to also let them know that, you know, Native people are here, still here, and living cultures?
Yes, it definitely is such a great way for us to educate one another. And that can also go back to my platform is building community with the shared understanding and education. That's when we can truly relate to one another and find the similarities between ourselves and other communities to build solidarity. So when we work on educating our general public and understanding the unique traits amongst our Pueblo people, the Navajo Nation, and our Apache tribes, as well as honoring the relationship that we have with our Ute relatives to the north, it all connects back. It all connects to we are still all citizens of this great country that we call home. And that we can continue to, you know, uplift each other because we all have resources that we need and there's always a great opportunity for us to Skillshare and build community.
And November celebrates Indigenous people with Native American Heritage Month. Tribal communities across the country celebrate our resilience all the time, not just during one month. But what are some of the highlights that you've been able to have so far?
Yes, and so, you know, with November being a month that is able to highlight our accomplishments and our achievements through, you know, since we have been here since time immemorial, it definitely is a way for us to bring to light the achievements and the wins and celebrate ourselves, and also to continue to uplift the needs that we have, the issues that we may be facing that we need help with. This is a time where we can, you know, call for that action and as well as to, you know, honor the truth of our existence here in what we call the United States of America and as well as in what the land that we call New Mexico as well. and honoring the, you know, making space for our Indigenous peoples to have a lens on them. And we also recognize that it is, you know, a time where a lot of pressure is on our Native peoples to show up and continue, you know, to build the awareness and the education around our issues. But it's also a time for us to celebrate with one another and continue to uplift each other. As well as, you know, some of the events that I've been a part of is, you know, of course, on November 1st, myself as a Pueblo person, this is a time where we honor our ancestors. So this was, you know, a great way to, you know, a grounding way for us to start with, you know, celebrating our indigeneity and our heritage and the cultures that we come from, because we carry that wherever we go in whatever spaces we are, you know, whether it is as an ambassador as myself or whether we're in, you know, boardrooms or continuing to show up in different ways. We carry our upbringing, we carry our values, our language, our knowledge, and that will never change. And it's always another way for us to become resilient because we're carrying that with us.
And you talked a little bit about challenges. There are a lot of challenges facing young Native people today, including when it comes to education. There's still, you know, poor graduation rates from high school, but you are interested in education as well and higher education. Why is that important for Native youth to finish high school and also maybe even pursue higher education?
Yes, you know, I think that, you know, education is always a lifelong journey for all of us, because we're always learning, you know, whether we are aware of it or not. We are taught different lessons from different people that engage, that come into our lives, and as well as understanding that we have an education because, or we have our public education that helps us to, you know, continue to be contributing members of the society. And that, you know, also comes into how do we become a contributing community member, not only in, you know, the Western society or the Western society, but also to, you know, understand what it means to be a contributing member in our own tribal communities. With education, it definitely is, you know, giving that level playing field and giving all of our people a chance to learn and contribute in a beneficial way. And that looks, whether that's going to a higher education institution such as college or a technical school, we honor all the journeys that education, what education looks like for our people. And that's always another way of us to continue to develop ourselves, because we are always ever changing, ever growing. And that's the way that we can be elders in training. That's the way to go.
I like that, elders in training. Well, as a young person, you're a longtime youth leader, and you have been locally and statewide. You've served as statewide and beyond as a youth leader. So why is youth leadership important? Do you see that older generations are now embracing younger voices?
Yes, I think that, you know, reflecting on my journeys and the relationship that we have, Antonia, you know, with myself working with the All Public Council of Governors Youth Committee, which I am the chair of, and also being a co-founder and member of the New Mexico State Indigenous Youth Council. And, you know, this is always like a great catalyst for change, is the inclusion of our young people and their voices and their needs, or their initiatives, if you will. And, you know, being part of the conversation too, because as we're navigating the change-making and decision-making process, this is a time where, you know, it not only affects our community members today, but this is beginning to make the changes for our future generations and for those that are going to be living in the society that we're creating now. So this is definitely a way for us to be informed. That would have to be the important part of this whole, you know, the whole inclusion, is educating each other about what is going on in our state, being civically engaged on the issues, and how do we all play a role in this, you know, not only with us being part of a tribal nation, if not only us being part of a tribal nation, it's also how do we recognize our relationship with the state, and how do we recognize that further relationship with our federal government, because we're all intertwined in this. And if we don't utilize our voice now, we are not being able to voice the needs and creating the world that we want to see and the beneficial change that is much needed.
And were there recommendations that came out of the Youth Council that went directly to the governor and the state legislature?
Oh, yes. As part of our Indigenous Youth Council, the main focus of our work was to call out the inequities that we saw during the pandemic, as well as honoring the holistic wellness journey that's needed in order for our communities to heal. So with that, we were able to continue to create a report and recommendations from our Youth Wellness Summit that was held with including all of the voices from our tribal nations throughout the state. And so this was a time for us to, you know, gather all of the voices and the needs from our young people from, you know, all the way down that are still in high school into how are we engaging our college and adult community members as we navigate towards being you know, fully, I guess, young adult community members and engaging them as they make their journey to being full adult community members.
And so how long is your reign as Miss India New Mexico? Is it a year?
Yes, it will be a year. So I was crowned on September 24th of 2022. And so I have a year. So now we're counting down and, you know, just still continuing to put forth the ideas that I have. And for me personally, I see this as a way of healing our communities and bringing that spirit of relationship building and kinship in our communities and, you know, bringing that, bringing back positivity and love and joy back into our communities, especially after healing after the COVID-19 pandemic, which is still ongoing. But it's important for us to continue to push forward. That's part of the resiliency that we are looked to and celebrated for. And also doing that in a safe manner, because we recognize that we have to protect all of our community members, especially our elders, because we saw, you know, unfortunately, throughout our communities, we saw the loss of that, of our, you know, our knowledge keepers. And this is our time for us to, you know, go and connect with them and, you know, continue to hold that so that we may pass it down to the future generation as well.
Well, thank you so much for joining us here today on New Mexico PBS, and happy National Native American Heritage Month.
Yes, thank you, Antonia. It means a lot, and definitely continue to hold space and continue to honor and carry your culture in whatever spaces you may be in, because that is who we are as Indigenous peoples, and that's what we continue to carry throughout not only the month of November, but throughout our lives and how we engage with people each and every day. So thank you.